dames en heren. Zo. Welkom bij Books Unlimited. En ik praat vanavond met twee gasten. Allebei de gasten ongeveer een half uur. Voor dit boek van Nino Haratishvili helaas maar een half uur. Want het is zo dik dat je ongeveer een maand aan het lezen bent. Het is te gek. And we're gonna do it in English now. Otherwise it will be a very weird program. Welcome. Nino, yesterday you were here already. And I'm gonna do a short summary of everything you already did.
Okay.
It will be shorter than the book. You're from Georgia, Tbilisi. And you had your breakthrough in 2013 with this 14 with this book, The Eighth Life for Brilka. Dit boek is pas vertaald. It's just been translated to Dutch, so it's good it made it to Holland. It's a family epic, and it tells the story of the fictitious Georgian Yashi family. And you take the reader to the Soviet Union, and in particular during the dramatic years when Georgian-born tyrant Stalin was in power. You also wrote theater, you wrote different books. Your debut novel was in 2010, it's called Juja.
Juja?
Juja. And followed by Mein Sanfter Zwilling, My Gentle Twin, in 2011. You're fairly young, you're from 1983. And now we're gonna talk about the book. And I wrote a little intro, hallelujah, this book, when I started reading the message to your grandmother, your father, and your Deda. Is that your mom in Georgian?
Deda is mother, yes.
All right. It was already beautiful. I'm gonna read it in Dutch. And it's mystic already, and it had me laying down on the ground for 10 minutes before I started. It's amazing. Is there somebody here who read the book? Yes. For all the people who didn't read it yet, buy it and go on a holiday for 3 weeks. That's a good deal, right? You write for mijn grootmoeder die me 1000 verhalen en een gedicht schonk. Voor mijn vader die me een tas vol vragen naliet. En voor mijn moeder die me vertelde waar ik de antwoorden zoeken moest. It's an epic start of a book and it's mystic already and it's emotional. That's also what the book is like. There's so much life in these 1300 page novel. It's a panopticon, some people called it that way. It's an epic story. But first, my first question, how did it come to life when the idea started?
It was not a decision that I just like, I sit down and write an epic novel.
Oh no.
so I've been always a kind of urgency about, I had a lot of questions about the history and the past because there's a historical analysis in Georgia did not really happen just like in several post-Sovietic countries because people were just trying to survive the last 25 years and I can somehow understand it. But I had a feeling that I, for example, I knew the European history just like the Nazism and from the Western point of view, kind of better than my own. So I had a lot of questions and I decided to write a book about a Georgian family, but about a period I can remember by myself because I was a child, about this perestroika period, the 90s. It was a really tough and terrible time for everybody in Georgia. I was a child, but so I remember a lot of things, just like corruption, inflation, civil wars, unemployment, and a lot of problems. Society fell apart, kind of. And that was on the other side, it was also a really emotional time because people tried to help each other and hold together because that was the only way to survive. And yeah, because it's really an important period also in my life and life of my family, I wanted to write about it. But when I started, I realized, okay, I would write this book in German because I live in German, I write in German, in Germany, and I write in German. So I knew nobody would understand it because I didn't understand it by myself because it was such a chaos, and everybody was fighting against each other, and I didn't really knew why. So I had to go back in time, and when I started to read and do research, it was kind of addiction. I could not really stop. So it was like a house with a lot of doors, and I was opening one by one and entering different rooms. So finally, I just like ended up at the October Revolution and was just
in
like,
1917.
Oops. So, but at that time, I already was so much into it that I could not really stop. So I said to myself, okay, just don't think about how huge it will be. You will worry about it when you finish with your publisher. So somehow I just, yes.
Wow, okay. Did you also then go back in time writing the book, or did you do the research first and then start all over again from the October Revolution until the point after the Soviet Union collapses?
I started to work on the idea how the book could be. For me, it was important because it's a fictional book, but the real history is the background of it, and it's inspired by the real history. So for me, it was important to find a perspective how to tell the story and how to write it without making an illusion, just like, okay, I'm a historian, I can tell you how it was, because of course I don't know how it was. It's kind of my imagination, my interpretation. So for me, it was important that it would be, the story would be told from the modern point of view, just like somebody who is living nowadays. And so I had the idea, okay, that should be for some or over some generations, and the last one will be telling the story to somebody who is younger. And that helped me, of course, somehow, because I could kind of disappear behind this character. And yes, I started, first of all, I started reading, but at one point I realized it's kind of not enough, and I had a good scholarship. It's for just like for journalists or writers who are doing research in Eastern Europe. Mm-hmm. And I, after 2 years, I had the opportunity just to concentrate only on that work, on that book. And I went to Moscow and St. Petersburg and did a lot of archive work.
Did you go to the KGB archives also?
They're not really, you're not allowed to access them. So this really famous Lubyanka, the KGB archive, mm-hmm. is still closed. So I think it will remain closed.
Forever?
I don't know.
Well, this
maybe,
is, yeah.
Maybe after the next revolution in Russia it will happen, but I can I cannot imagine that under Putin is going to happen. So
why? No, I'm kidding. Yesterday evening you also were here, and you were in another short interview, and you already told that there were a lot of stories in your head that made this book possible. And if I may ask, you're from Georgia, were there specific stories from your family that you like fictionalized but took with you in the book? Because it must be part of every family in most of the Soviet countries, these stories that are in the book about mm-hmm. trading people or not trusting everybody mm-hmm. or having to choose between a lover or well, yeah. Power
yeah, they're not quite. It's not autobiographically. I'm yeah. Fortunately, it mm-hmm. is not my family history. This book, but of course, a lot of things are kind of, you can generalize them. And I think first of all, the feelings, this skepticism, fear, just like not trusting in kind of state structures, police, just like. Yeah, I think almost every Soviet person I've met was always seeing himself just like outside of state, was kind of an enemy. Mm-hmm. And of course, there have been a lot of stories that somehow I knew them by my mother or friends of her, but they're not quite just like, okay, it's not a personal story of somebody that I took and put it in a book, or but I think the feelings, it's most just like, yeah, the atmosphere, the feelings, there are a lot of people they would recognize, a lot of things in that book who lived at that time, so.
There are a lot of characters in the book, and one of my favorite but also not favorite characters is Stasia, the grandmother. Do you have a favorite character? Because it's a really big family. It's the Yashi family, and it starts with a chocolate brewer, something like that. It's a man who has a chocolate factory, and his daughter is Stasia. Is there a favorite character? Because there are so many kids and lovers, and they go away, they get killed.
Come back.
Yes. Ta-ta.
It's difficult to say because, you know, Stasia is really a special one because Stasia is the character I spent the most of my time with her, because it took me 4 years to write and work on that book, and it was a great opportunity to have the chance to just like describe somebody from the birth, and she gets really old, 99. Yes. So I had kind of the whole century and all the different ages of one person and woman. So it was quite a challenging, but also I loved it, because you can show somebody in really so many different ways when you have such a huge period. But somehow, when you spend so much time with characters, it felt, at one point, I felt just like they're my family, and they were quite real. So sometimes I try to, because in Germany there are a lot of people are saying, okay, the men are so kind of bad, or and I start to defend them. So I really like somehow Georgi Alania. He's not a main character, but an important one for me. And so he's doing a really bad job. Somehow he's a good guy for me. But I cannot really say that there's somebody who I really love the most, or, yeah.
And how did you leave them behind when the book was finished?
Oh, it took me quite a long time, because after finishing, I was touring around with that book. In Germany, people love these readings, you know, you're just like going from bookstore to bookstore or library or theater, and I had to read kind of 1 hour every day for just like more than 1 year.
Now you're here.
But now I had a quite long break.
So, okay.
And now I don't have to read for an hour, and talking is quite, yes. Well,
this is the part that comes after that, did you know?
Okay, I tried to read in Dutch. So it was not so easy, but then I become a mother, so for 1 year, so that was quite helpful.
Yeah, another kind of attention.
Yes, the book was just like thrown away, and but I was really sad and happy. I remember that moment when I finished that book, and somehow I was also frightened, because I thought, okay, how I'm going to live, what I'm going to do next morning. I forgot everything else. So, but it was also, of course, I was kind of really happy. But yeah.
And it's called in Dutch Het Achtste Leven voor Breelka. Voor Breelka staat is between two, I don't know how you call it, haakjes in Dutch. Thank you. The eight lives. Yeah, can we spoil this one? Shall we do it?
I don't know what you're going to spoil, but do it.
It has 7 parts.
Yeah. Oh, okay. But you mean this final thing?
Yes.
Oh, it's not a spoiler.
It's not a spoiler. Read the book. It's amazing. It's this big. There are still a lot of surprises in the book, really.
It means this last page.
Yeah, because I think the last page is really important, and that's why I wanted to talk about this, because it's about the era of the Soviet Union. And Brilka, who is also in the family tree already in the book, and the person Nita who tells the story to her, this whole book is aimed, it's told to Brilka, and Brilka is born in 1993, 2 years after the Soviet Union collapses, and she's actually the first one who is born in a free, corrupted country. why? I think it's a beautiful way of not ending the book. It's an opening.
You know, after dealing with so much terrible stuff, and I had to deal with a lot of terrible documents and stories and really depressing things, and there have been quite a lot of moments when I thought, oh, why am I doing that? But I knew from the beginning I needed to end this book kind of hopefully, and that was really important to me. And it was the first thing that I really knew. I want to end this book with an unwritten page. So, because the whole story Nita is telling to her niece, and she's only 14 years old at that time, is kind of trying to rewrite something you have to know all this, what's behind you, to start anew, to become a new beginning for your life, for your dreams, to be able to kind of, how to say it, Fluch durchbrechen. Just like it's kind of curse, I think it's right word.
Break the curse.
Yeah,
somehow.
Break the curse, and you can do it only when you really kind of analyze things and you're aware of them. I do believe so, and I hoped that it would somehow help Brilka. So yes, it's just like for me, it's a little. It's my way to show that there should be some hope that she will kind of begin a new life and will do things that she would love to.
Let's talk a little bit more about hope, but also about fate, because they're destiny, maybe.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Because there's one thing that keeps coming back in the book. It's the chocolate.
Yeah.
Every time something goes wrong or someone is unhappy or maybe happy, the secret recipe from the chocolate factory man comes to the table and everybody gets to eat it.
Yes, the chocolate thing. In the beginning, I didn't want to make it somehow magical or just like mystery or something. I wanted to start a book with something really sensual and something that people really love. And I think most of the people love chocolate. And I wanted the chocolate factory owner to have a profession that he could kind of give to his something that he could just like address or give to his daughter.
That could stay in the generations also, or
yes, somehow. And but for me, it was important because I knew after this beginning, it comes a cut. It comes a revolution, and things change and become gray and tough and no more sensual. And that was the first idea. But afterwards, I also did a lot of interviews with people who lived in the Soviet Union and their memories. And a lot of people mentioned the word destiny or fate. Mm-hmm. And I started to, during the whole period I was writing and working on the book, I was thinking about this word. What does it mean? And do we, just like my generation or people in Western world, do we use it? Do we believe in it? So I wanted to question this because could not find an answer, and I think it's all impossible. but I wanted to question the question I had also to have to address to the readers, and so there are characters in that book that do believe in this kind of fate, because you know, in this totalitarian state and regime, it was impossible for people. Just it was somehow maybe helpful to believe that there is an instance above, and they're really helpless, because often they just use sentences like, "I could not change it. I could not deal with that because it was just like that way." And and maybe, yeah, maybe it was somehow helpful for them. But and in that book, maybe also a main question is how much the politics maybe kind of, how much, is it possible to have a private life in structures like Soviet Union have been, or this totalitarian.
The terrible word. Yes. That's why it isn't there anymore. In one interview talking about this, you talked already about your grandmother who was working in a factory, your Georgian grandmother, but also read Bulgakov, mm-hmm. who wrote a story about the devil coming to Moscow. Mm-hmm. Is that there's something two-faced about the Soviet Union being living there, I think. It's like looking away, but being there at the same time.
Yes, that's a good metaphor. Maybe I don't know. Yes. I often there have been just like Widerspruch. What's right word for what's the English word?
Contradiction.
Yes. Soviet Union is one contradiction. Just like everything is, it's not really logical. Because people are, they in one sentence, somebody can tell you, okay, I really do believe in Stalin because it was kind of necessary.
And he helped us win the war and...
Yes, win the war. And in the next sentence, somebody's telling you about the beautiful poetry of Anna Akhmatova.
Yes.
So it's kind of, they coexist. All the parallels, all the contradiction. I cannot really explain after 4 years of researching that. I cannot really get it. But you know, one of the most intense moments I had in the research, and that helped me really somehow to understand the pervert state, was I was in Sakharov Center. It's a kind of political center there. Yeah, they're trying to analyze the past and doing a lot of panels and discussions are always threatened by from outside. And they had a discussion with a really old man who spent, I don't know, 12 or 13 years in a gulag. Mm-hmm. And he was deported and he didn't really knew why. So what he did.
He was maybe just picked out of a mess and then they brought him to the camp.
Maybe somebody wanted his flat or I don't know, something like that. So he lost everything, his life, his wife, his family, so on. And he described the day when Stalin died. And he described that every prisoner went out and started to scream and shout and cry and just like doing that this way. Mm-hmm. And I was just like, I couldn't really understand that. And even he just like went out and was really shocked. And he described it just like, I couldn't really imagine how the life will go on after he was like a god. It's not possible that he could die. And
like the system was falling apart in a good way, but also in a bad way because you didn't know what to do with the situation.
No, he was kind of really, really sad. He wasn't glad or happy. And afterwards, I asked him how it's possible. How can he explain that he was not really kind of happy that somebody who was the reason of his tragedy died. And he told me the sentence and it explained to me really a lot. It helped me to understand a lot of things about the system. He said, you know, I didn't know why I was imprisoned, but I thought he would know.
Yeah.
Because he
That's
was not
funny.
He was not questionable, you know? He was just like really a god. And he was allowed to destroy
millions of lives.
And he said, yes, after so many years, when I talk about that, I cannot explain it by myself, but somehow we all felt this way. So, yeah.
I'm gonna ask the last question, because in the coulisses they're looking at me like this. You're writing a new book, you told me about it. That's not a question, but just for the people to know, there are coming, more books are coming. And read this one. And I want to read a little bit, because I think that's also you and Nitsa, and it's... I thought it was one of the most beautiful parts of the book. We all read it backstage in Dutch, and I'm gonna do it in Dutch now too. It's Nitsa, so Nitsa is talking to Brioka when she's writing this story. Vroeger, toen ik ongeveer zo oud was als jij, Brioka, heb ik me vaak afgevraagd hoe het zou zijn als het collectieve geheugen van de mensheid andere dingen had onthouden en weer andere was vergeten. Als alle oorlogen en al die ontelbare koningen, heersers, leiders en huurlingen waren vergeten en er in de boeken alleen mensen waren overgebleven die met hun eigen handen een huis hebben gebouwd, een tuin aangelegd, een giraffe ontdekt, een wolk beschreven of de hals van een vrouw bezongen. Ik heb me afgevraagd hoe we weten dat degene van wie de naam voortbestaat beter, wijzer of interessanter zijn. Alleen omdat ze de tijd hebben doorstaan. Want waar blijven diegenen die vergeten zijn? Is it like... To me, this is the center of the book, because you write about, not only about, you know, the cruelty is woven into the story, but it's about people, normal people, living their lives. That's not a question. Really. I'm sorry. Is it like an ode to the normal people always fighting through the stuff?
I hope so. Of course, there were really a lot of cruelty, but that was the whole research, the whole period. I've been in Germany, I've been often asked why I should have to describe such cruel things. And I answered, there is nothing that I can invent that is not already invented by reality. And I somehow felt obliged, or it would be not really honest if I would not write about these terrible things. But on the other hand, there are so many... During the whole research, there have been, you know, one day I was just like, oh, why I'm doing that? And next day I met such great people who are so human, so full of empathy, who helped each other and did a lot of great things. So this terrible, terrible time. And, you know, it's both. And I tried to somehow represent it in a book. And yes, of course, I hope they will fight and... maybe it's an utopistic or naive thought or hope, but I hope that what you said, I cannot.
Yes, I think we're there.
Maybe it's an ode. Yes.
I have to send you away now. It's terrible. Nino Haritz, really, thank you so much. I hope I can read your book. Your new book soon, and all the other books have to be translated. Can I have one warm applause, please?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And now I have to stay here all by myself. Alain Mabankou. Where are you? Oh, you're already here, yes. Please come up. I'm so lonely. Thank you. Hey. Thank you. Ça va bien?
Okay.
Bonsoir.
Bonsoir. I was told that it's going to be in French anyway.
No.
Oh, man.
That would be terrible for me.
Yes, but it would be terrible for me in English anyway.
Maybe we can do it halfway.
Maybe you can teach me the Dutch.
It's gonna be quick. It's a terrible language.
Oh, it's not terrible. No, come on. Don't disappoint people like me who want to learn your culture.
Huh? Well, we have two. We have de, het, and un, and that's where it ends, really, when you want to learn Dutch.
For the time being, I remove my hat just to pay you tribute.
Thank you.
Yes.
Alama Bankou, where should I start? You were born in Congo Brazzaville in 1966.
Correct.
Oh. you spent a part of your youth in Europe. You teach at UCLA. You wrote Bleu, Blanc, Rouge, and you won the Grand Prix Littéraire de l'Afrique Noire. Mm-hmm. Am I still right?
Correct.
Okay. Your latest book is Petit Piment, and translated into English as Black Moses in 2017, and it's also out in Dutch, Prince Paper. It's amazing. We're going to talk about it tonight. Mm-hmm. And one thing before we start, this is also an essay book you wrote, Le Monde est mon langage.
Langage, yes.
Langage. Excuse me.
It's okay. Excuse my French.
It's your motto.
Yeah, Le Monde est mon langage. It's like I wanted to explain to people that... Nowadays, we don't care about the fact that you are white, black, yellow, rainbow. We need to connect just because we feel good together, like as we are talking today. If you are feeling good, we are creating the world. So the world is language. So what is important is what you are saying to me. If it is like meaningful, I'm going to use it in order to create my own identity.
I think this is the best start of the talk we can have, because this is what I was aiming for. Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you. We're finished. You can go.
No. It's okay.
Because I read about you, and I find this the most fascinating thought. Because yesterday you had to talk. Also, you did the opening lecture.
Oh, that was great.
Yeah?
But difficult for me. At the same time, it was great honor, but I have a sheep on my shoulder.
Because you had to start?
That the first time I was talking in front of people of your country, because at the time, people coming from Netherlands, I was in Congo, they were like priests. They came with the Bible to teach us, who is God? So we were astonished to see that God was like represented like white, and we said, how can we do in order to anyway understand the message, even if the image pictured by the people is white? But you did a good job. You didn't colonize us, but you teach us anyway how to be kind to the other people. That way I accepted to come here.
Wow, okay. We're going to take a lot of different steps in this talk, but it's okay. In your book, so now I'm going to go to your book, because you're talking about the Dutch people coming. This was one of my favorite lines, and it's in the beginning. There are also good lines in other parts.
I hope, because otherwise I would have written just 2 pages. So,
Short story. I'm sorry, I'm going to read it in Dutch. Toen de blanken naar Afrika kwamen, hadden wij het land en zij de Bijbel. Ze leerden ons bidden met de ogen dicht. En toen we ze weer open deden, hadden de blanken het land en wij de Bijbel.
Yes. That would, that's what I was talking about. You know, even if you spoke in Dutch, since I wrote the book, I know what you said. Yes, they brought us the Bible. You have to pray. And when we opened the eyes, it was late. You had the land and we have the Bible.
It's a terrible trade.
It's very difficult if you have the Bible and you don't have the land. That's the problem with the Palestinian over there. They have the Bible, but they don't have the land.
Mm-hmm.
So pushing the people everywhere. So that's the significance of Africa nowadays. The colonization brought us like a kind of principles. But if we see closely, we don't have nothing. Whereas we have everything in the continent. We can be rich. We have gas. We have oil. We didn't want to fight, but they came over there to take African, to come to fight to the First World, Second World, World War. We didn't even know. And they said, no, you have to kill those people over there. But they said, they are white like you. No, just kill them because they are German. So we killed them. And at the end of the day, now they are calling us the migrants.
Yes.
Yeah, so I don't know who's migrants.
I don't know.
Yeah.
You wrote about this, and I had the word copied somewhere.
No,
in my,
take your time. We've got time. Don't worry.
Yes, thank you. It was about the in an interview.
Yeah.
You talked about the Senegalese soldiers. There's a special name for them.
Yes,
in
we
in
call
France.
Them tirailleurs sénégalais.
Yes.
Yes, they were not only Senegalese, but it was black people who came to the Europe in order to help France to win the war, because you know France was occupied by German, so it was the occupation, like we say, over there. So France needed to rely to his empire, like Congo, Gabon, Cameroon, please come here, come fight here, otherwise France gonna disappear. So black people said, no, France not gonna disappear. So we came here, we fought for France, for the greatness of the French Republic, but at the same time, we didn't receive the tribute. They give us like a medal. So we got the medal, but we didn't have like the respect, the due respect of the fact that a lot of black people died for the greatness of France. So if I'm writing, if I'm a writer, it's also to remind Europe that if it's for fighting for the freedom, we don't care about the color of the skin. If someone is like dying, I'm gonna save him. I'm not gonna say, oh, he's just an Asian or an European who's dying, he's not black, so I don't care. No, I'm gonna care because it's someone who is dying is like me because he want to live. So when you see all the discussions nowadays about the fact that who is who, why black are here, we don't want them here, but we were brought in Europe by Europe, and now the Europe want to send us back over there, but they need to be careful because tomorrow if something happens,
are
here,
they gonna call? Or
they're
they
gonna call again,
call?
African people to come, and then we're gonna say no, please, we did it already.
Thank you.
Just
bye.
Deal with your stuff yourself. Yeah.
This migration and I think also intersectionality and identity—they are a big part of your writing. Mm-hmm. You did this this essay book I already talked about, the title is Le Monde et
Mon Langage.
You
see, they need to translate it into Dutch. Huh?
Yes,
because
they
so
should.
If we have a publisher here, so translate it for my sister, because she needs to read it.
I'm going to read it in English. I already talked to your agent about it.
Okay, she's somewhere here.
She will send me a copy.
She needs to do her job, because if it's not translated, it's because of her. She didn't do her job. So
no,
we're gonna
let's keep her out of this, please.
We're going to fire her.
No.
Yeah, we have
let's
to fire
stay
her.
On the stage.
Okay,
let's
we're
going to
keep her.
You wrote this essay book, and now there's this book. People are expecting us to talk about it, so let's do it. And we'll come back to the other themes again, I think. I hope. This is about a young boy, Black Moses, or Moses, or I'll just read his full name as stated in the book.
And in Lingala?
Yes. Please don't make me, make me do this once.
I'm going to help you.
Tokumisa Nzambe Pomose Ya Moyindo Abotami Namboka Ya Bakoko. Meaning.
Bravo.
Yes?
Bravo.
Meaning, thank God, Black Moses is born on the soil or land. I did translate it freely. Of our ancestors. This is about a boy, Moses. He lives in an orphanage in Luango, and all of a sudden, seemingly in one day or in a short period of time, this place turns from a deeply religious place to a Soviet kind of pioneer camp.
Yes.
Why did you choose this time in history? It's the 70s?
Yes, because it's my time. I'm now 51, and I think that this character is like me. I lived in that age of communism in Africa. Mm-hmm. We received like Soviet Union, we received like Bulgaria, Romania, all those kind of principles coming from Karl Marx, Lenin, and reading this kind of philosophy in which the devil was the capitalism, Europe was like the devil. So we needed to be reunited. So the communism was the perfect ideology for African people. So that character was, you read perfectly the name in Lingala.
Thank you.
I would like to congratulate you for that kind of greatness in your reading. The name is like in slam, it's Tokumisa Nzambe Pomose ya Moyindo wa Botami na Mboka ya Bakoko. That's his name. Yeah, but you read it very good with the Dutch accent.
It's yeah, thank you.
Yeah, so that kid is like the perfect example of how the ideologies coming from Europe did change the way of living in Africa. We were living quietly with our own customs, and they say that, oh no, now you have to read Karl Marx, you have to read Engels, you have to embrace Soviet Union, you have to think that everything in this country belongs to everybody, even if you're gonna have people who are poor, with people who are rich, but we lived with the idea that the richness of the country belongs to everybody. It's like you're gonna say that I'm rich, but you cannot use your richness. So this guy, Tokumisa Nzambe Pomose ya Moyindo wa Botami na Mboka ya Bakoko, is someone who is trying like to face the institution. He's an orphan. He's someone who doesn't have the mother, the father, and is living in the street. He's trying to learn how to struggle. I tried throughout this book to explain to the people how the streets is more powerful than the institutions
yes.
in Africa.
Because first he is in the orphanage and then he decides mm-hmm. to leave. He decides to break out, and
yeah.
it's quite easy. Mm-hmm. And he goes to Pointe Noire.
Yes, Pointe Noire, which is like one of the main city in Congo Brazzaville. So, as you know, we have two Congo: Congo Kinshasa, which was colonized by the Belgium, and Congo Brazzaville, colonized by the French. They speak French over there. And then Pointe Noire is like the economic capital. We have oil, we have the sea, we have everything over there. And that the city where I came from. So Petit Piment, that guy with the longest name in the African literature. He lives, it's the longest name in African literature anyway. So he lives in Pointe Noire, he's mm-hmm. gonna grow up over there, he's gonna face a lot of situation. He was raised by the prostitutes.
Yes.
Maman 500, the name is Maman Fiat 500. I don't know the name they give in Lyon.
Yeah, name. It's the same, Maman Fiat 500.
Ah, voilà, voilà. Mama Fiat found the founder.
It's because, a great car. It's
yes,
wonderful.
Yes, because she has this car, 500, she would like drive it. So we called her Mama Fiat 500. So he was like with a lot of kids over there, a lot of women being the prostitute. But for us, we didn't see her like a prostitute. She was that like a kind of mother for all the kids. If you want to eat something, you go knock the door of the prostitute. She's going to give you what you have to eat and so on and so on. So Maman Fiat 500, in that book, like she's like an example of the power of women in Africa. Here in Europe, if someone is a prostitute, you're going to criticize.
Mm-hmm.
For us, she helped a lot of people to survive, to eat, to be straight, because sometimes if you don't go to school, the prostitute gonna come and hit you. You have to go to school. That's great.
Yeah, that's wonderful. let's talk a little bit more about the boys from Pointe Noire, because your book starts with a dedication, and it's dedicated to the zwervers. Some words seem to disappear on me while you I'm here in your presence.
Dedicated to someone whose name is Petit Piment.
Yes, and it's also for the boys who live there at the Côte Sauvage.
Yes.
And the dedication also says that they told you parts of their life story. How did it go?
It can be said that yes, it's a fiction, but at the same time, I went back to the Congo. You know, I lived for like 20 years in France. I didn't go back to the Congo, and I went back 20 years later in the Congo. So I met a lot of people. So over there, if they know that you are a writer, everybody wants to talk to you. They come, you know, you are a writer. Yes, oh, yeah, I have a lot to say. You have to put me on your book.
That's so, also another book, right? About the guy writing.
That was fact that before that book, Petit Piment, I wrote a book called The Lights of Pointe Noire, in French, Lumière de Pointe Noire. It was a real book in which I depict my mother, my father, the uncle, people outside, the real people sailing here and there. So all my family was depicted in the book. So when I went back over there, I met one uncle who came home and he had the book. He said, your book is great. I said, yes, it's great. He said, it's a lot of pages. Yes, a lot of pages. And he said, everybody is in. Yes, it's everybody is in, but I'm not in your book.
Oh, no.
And then he said that I'm very disappointed because you put even this guy, Montpero, he didn't do nothing in your life. I'm the one who carry you. You were crying. I would like change your... I did everything for you. And at the end of the day, you went to France and you published a book with 400 pages. I'm not there. And then he told me that the next book, I want you to put me in your book. I said, oh, it's okay. No. I don't want to be in the middle or in the, I want to be in the beginning. It's okay. So what can I do? So I tried to put my uncle in the book, but it was very difficult.
Why?
Because I didn't have something to say about him, nothing, beside what I'm telling you now. So then I meet someone whose nickname is Petit Piment. Mm-hmm. He was sitting in the street, seeing me passing by, and he was telling me his own story. I said to myself, no, I'm not going to write about my uncle, but I'm going to write about Petit Piment. And through Petit Piment, maybe I can put my uncle inside. So Petit Piment become this book, and the uncle is somewhere over there, but he didn't understand. Still now, he's calling me and saying, yes, but it's Petit Piment, I'm not still there. So I'm writing a book in which he's going to be there. For the time being, it's Petit Piment who witnessed how we were growing over there. He's a madman, so he knows everything about Pointe Noire. He's tried to explain me the city, and I tried to write his story over there. But I did add a lot of fiction, a lot of my own life, in order to make the reader feel comfortable.
Yeah, it's a wonderful book because there's something I did not read before, really, that it's so oral that one story grasps into another and then there's another and you have all these layers and at the same time you're in one place and one person is telling the story. Mm. It's amazing.
Maybe it's my culture. I think that I prefer to be called like a storyteller than a novelist. Because I don't want to impress people. I want people just to know that the power of the what we call parole, what you are saying is more important than what you are writing. The oral transition is very important, you know. If you go in my family, you say that, yes, you have to pay me because you signed. He said, yes, I signed, but I didn't say that. Yes, it's very important what you are saying. You're going to say, you signed here. Yes, I signed, but I didn't say that. So the parole is more important than what is written. But in your culture, in Europe,
yeah, we you, have know, a really
you buy a house, you have to sign. You marry a woman, you have to sign. No, we don't sign. We just say something which is more powerful, because if you read the Bible, what it say there, at the beginning, it was the word. It wasn't that God said, no. In French, it's au commencement était la parole. At the beginning, it was the word, and the word began to become the world.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, and I'm gonna. I have 10 minutes left. I'm gonna try to.
No, we're not gonna separate now.
I'm gonna try to bring two things together. That is the word and the title of your essay book. That's called Le Monde et mon langage.
You like that book?
I want to read it. Huh? But apart from that, I want to bring two things together. I'm gonna try because we're gonna go to France now, and we're gonna go to.
To France?
Yes. No, what? Not now.
Oh, but okay. Thank you.
Here on stage.
I don't want to go there.
No, I'm sorry.
Let's stay here in Netherlands.
We're gonna go to Chateau Rouge, because I think I read some things about Chateau Rouge. It's your favorite arrondissement in Paris. It's the 18th.
I bought a house over there, so it's simple.
Okay.
Voilà.
But
all
wait,
the,
just
man,
wait
all
for
the
it. Wait.
Money French people give me because I sell books. I said, okay, I'm going to buy around the world. Black people, Arabic,
yes.
Pakistanians, Chinese lives. I live in one of the most diverse arrondissements in Paris, which is 18th arrondissement. You have Chateau Rouge, you have the black market, the African coming over there. You can buy everything which is in Africa, but in France. I want to stay there because I don't want to miss Africa. I want to be close to African culture. So if you need like to know the African culture, you have to live in Chateau Rouge. You take the metro, you go there. You can like stop at Chateau Rouge or Barbès or I don't know, somewhere over there. And then you're going to see the real picture of the France like I want it. Black people, white people, Arabic, Pakistanian, everywhere. Yeah. That's my neighborhood, and I'm not like ashamed of living over there. I think that that's the best part of France. It's not 16e arrondissement or Champs-Élysées, Boulevard des Champs-Élysées, Café, I don't know what the name of the café. Lilan, voilà. Where the La Coupole. Thank you, madame. Oh, you should be here with us. Okay. Coupole and so on and so on. Yes. But I need the other kind of cafe in which you are sitting over there. We are talking about Africa, dictatorship, how to cook, I don't know, the manioc, which is a cassava.
Mm-hmm.
You eat it very well. Or how to cook pâte d'arachide. You take, like, I don't know the name. But anyway, that's the best place in France. Don't go to France just to go to Boulevard Saint-Michel and Montparnasse and La Sorbonne, but go at Barbès. Go at Max Dormois, La Gare du Nord, Boulevard de la Chapelle, where you're going to be like, I'm scared, but it's good to be scared.
Well, I was there 2 years ago, and I had dinner at a Congo Brazzaville restaurant. It was wonderful.
You see?
Yes, there was a woman singing Amy Winehouse, ordering people around, serving drinks, and throwing glass on the floor. It was amazing.
Yeah,
but to bring it together, I think, is that the word is your the world is your language.
Voilà, le monde est mon langage.
Is that the Chateau Rouge, the telling stories, isn't that the way everything should come together? That it's normal. Shouldn't you talked about Europe not being used to having influenced Africa and the other way around?
Mm-hmm. Yes, but I think that after all, that book means only that Europe is Africa.
Yes.
Because Africans know more Europe than Europeans are customers with Africa. They came over there, they colonized people just to give, you have to learn Dutch, you have to learn French, you have to learn Spanish. But the African was learning Spanish, French, Dutch, and so on and so on, but they kept all the languages. So nowadays, if you put like a European here and the African here, the African can speak your languages. But you cannot speak African languages because you did consider those languages like that president is shit holes. It's not good. Voilà. But at the end of the day, you understand that you cannot like define your own culture without reading what African people are saying. But each time you have two Africans, when they are speaking about Europe. So you need to know what they are speaking in their languages. That's why I always support all the European people who want to learn more about African culture, because I know the history of Europe. I read everything. I know your country, even if I didn't come here, but I know what has happened. I know where you were. I know what place you were in South Africa. I know everything. I know everything about French people, the colonization, the Spanish, everything. But at the same time, I'm very shocked to see that Europe didn't take the time to understand the African cultures. That's why we have sometimes tumultuous relations, because they perceive the African just like people who are coming here to invade, to try to steal the European bread and go back to Africa. No, I think that we have maybe a problem of reading together the same history.
And this is going to be my final question.
Already?
Yes, I'm sorry.
Okay, let's go.
She's really angry already.
Who?
Okay.
Well, okay. It's okay.
Yeah.
We're going to pay her a coffee and it's going to be there.
Do you think, because we talked about storytelling people are here to hear about stories and books and literature. Do you think right now there's a big movement also in literature about intersectionality, about gender, about race? Mm. Do you think literature and telling stories, words, world can bridge the gaps?
Yes, I think that...
Or is now the time maybe for literature to start bridging the gaps as first?
Literature have been building the bridge for a while, but just because we don't have all the part of the literature in the world. Now you are discovering the African literature.
It's amazing.
Yes, it's amazing, but it's very late. Because yes. We know who's Marcel Proust, we know who's Montesquieu, we know who's Kafka in Africa, but you don't know who's Amadou Kourouma, who's Léopold Sédar Senghor, who's Chikaya Utamsi. It's a big part of the world. When you're going to discover the deepness of African literature, you're going to say, but how come we didn't take the time to read all this material? We would have avoided maybe the First World, the Second World. We did avoid like racism and so on and so on. We African writers are talking about the world. We are not preaching a kind of hate.
Mm-hmm.
In African literature, you're going to find maybe the last voice which is going to call you to be close to us, to reunite, and maybe to dance together with the same music, with the same rhythm, in order to create another world.
Bam!
Never. Merci. Bon, mais merci madame.
Merci beaucoup. Okay.